funny thing happened on the way to Mars.
Would you be shocked to find out that the greatest moment in our recent history may not have happened at all?
So this is a little video I'm doing about Capricorn One, which of course is the film that a lot of people speculate and say that that Capricorn One started all the Apollo hoax rumors.
Cronkite was talking with somebody who was doing one of the Apollo shots. They cut to what they called a simulation, and it was mock-ups and models done on a stage, and it looked exactly like the real thing. And I said, wow, that, how do we know?
It's a great simulation. You have to see there, if you could see it.
That little fly speck is supposed to be a lens.
Yeah. As soon as they stepped foot on the moon on Apollo 11, there were people who just didn't believe it from the get-go. And this is in America as well. So it's not something you're really that conscious of these days. You think it's a new thing, really, since the 80s and beyond. But no, there were people from day one who wouldn't believe us.
I'm not quite sure what to believe and what not to believe. I mean, originally, when they did step on the moon, there were a lot of people that said that that was not true. One just doesn't know what to think anymore.
First thing to notice is that's clearly a Saturn V on the launch pad. So there's no way this mission is going to Mars. And in fact, I believe that the original novel was written as a moon hoax rather than Mars. They moved it to Mars for the movie, so I don't know what the reasons there are for. Maybe it's just too close to home, maybe it was just too much of a nerve to hit. And at least doing it to Mars, it kind of suggests to the public that, yeah, this is just a total act of make-believe, that basically going to the moon is okay, we can do that, that's easy, but going to Mars is just too much of a stretch. So maybe so. I think to go to Mars they'd need like 3 or 4 or 5 Saturn V's to get there. So you notice that sun's moving from right to left, so this is clearly a sunset played backwards. Now this is the opening shot of the movie, so perhaps the filmmaker here is telling you that what is about to follow is, you know, this is all about fakery. This is another one of these sort of embedded Hollywood messages. And yeah, this first scene as well sets up a little bit of sort of humanism. So clearly this is one of the engineers who has spent his life working on NASA and working on these missions. Okay, and he presents to them a Bible. There's the cross up here as well. Cross in a circle. I know it's an emergency medikit kind of symbol, but still composed while the astronauts are receiving a Bible. Maybe significant, maybe not. But what this scene gives you is it's telling you that these engineers are sincere. They are actually working on real engineering projects. The fact that these projects don't end up going to the moon doesn't matter. They may be just dumped into the sea, whatever. They're not completing what they're doing, but various contracting departments are delivering contracted services and products, and that's the whole point of this thing. It's trillions and trillions of dollars has gone through NASA, and this all goes to these firms, these contractors like Boeing, Grumman. Move on a bit. So of course, you know, they're pulled out of the spaceship and taken away. Launch carries on. So here's one of the aspects of the Apollo moon hoax. When you may question that Apollo 11 landed on the moon. Oh, it was faked. You say, yep, I saw it on TV. How could they fake the launch? You know, there were people there. Well, like I said before about these engineering projects, you know, the Saturn V is real. It might not function exactly as it's supposed to. It might not have everything it needs to actually fulfill its mission, because they've got that covered. All it has to do is look like it's going to fulfill the mission, and then they're just going to fill in data to make it look like it's nailed the mission. So there you are. It's taken off without the astronauts. Everybody now believes that the astronauts are on board. And this rocket is, in the movie, going to Mars. So yeah, they're pulled out, and this guy who's obviously the main... He's the main, say, baddie in the movie. That's not really the case, I suppose. He's the main instigator. He's the audience's main focal point for the hoax.
I remember when Glenn made his first orbit in Mercury. They put up television sets in Grand Central Station, and tens of thousands of people missed their trains to watch. You know, when Apollo 17 landed on the moon, people were calling up the networks and bitching because reruns of I Love Lucy were canceled.
So, of course, here the lander is clearly, it's a moon lander. It's very much from the Apollo program. So there's no way that's landing on Mars. So again, this is another kind of doff of the cap to the fact that this is all about the moon. It's Saturn V, there's the Apollo moon lander. It's not about Mars at all. They have these cameras on the set as well. I don't know whether, again, it's another signal to the audience to be paying attention. It's like, so if they've got a fixed camera there and they're showing that during the fact that they should be on Mars to the TV audience at home, then that TV audience at home should be saying, where's that fixed camera from? So why is there a fixed camera on this set? That doesn't make sense. The cameras should replicate exactly what the astronauts are doing.
A funny thing happened on the way to Mars.
There you are. Bart, there's your cue there. A funny thing happened on the way to Mars.
It's gotten too big. It's in the hands of grown-ups.
What about our families?
They're flying back from the Cape to Houston. They're all together on the plane.
So, and of course, it's bigger than just NASA and these folks, and the families are threatened, and this guy's under pressure from above, and it's just a big knotty mess, basically. And here's Elliot Gould's character, the press reporter. It's an interesting little bit of modern culture reference.
After a while, you won't know what city you're in. I defy anyone to tell me the difference between the Holiday Inn in Houston and the Holiday Inn in Cincinnati. The rooms are the same, the music in the elevators is the same.
You could see it was already taking hold in America in 77. Our town centres were starting to be fairly homogenous as well. So, and basically one of the console operators at NASA detects a bit of a problem.
What seems to be the problem?
Well, I just can't figure something out, sir.
What is that?
Well, I'm not exactly sure, but it's in the readout. I spoke to Dr. Bergen about it a long time ago, and he said it was in the console.
So he's already raised it.
What console are you on?
Telemetry's a 36.
Oh, yes, Dr. Bergen told me about that. We had that console repaired.
I know, sir. It's just I keep on having the same readouts.
What readout?
Well, sir, I ran a program on my own just to check something, and the readout's different.
You ran your own program.
So this guy's run his own program, run his own checks, and discovered that things don't quite tally. What the scene's also telling you as well is that this guy told his direct supervisor previously, and now he's gone right up to the flight director. It's telling you here as well that the senior guys here are conspiring against the junior technician. By the way, his response, oh yeah, console 36. Yeah, I know about that. We've had it. We've had problems. We've had it repaired. So he's clearly lying, because there aren't problems with the console. So both of this guy's two senior bosses are both lying. So I noticed here how he picks up a black phone here just after the guy has left. So the suggestion here is that he's reporting this guy somehow upstairs into the shadows. Now, when I saw that, it did strike me, because in the Columbia disaster, the Columbia re-entry failure, they show you they go into lockdown procedures, and one of the ground controllers turns around to the flight director and reminds him that they have no way of disabling the black phones. And I remember thinking that was odd at the time, thinking that that kind of, that's an indication that NASA is within the sphere of the federal system of the American government. It's not its own thing. It's not doing its own thing. They have black phones that they cannot disconnect.
GC flight. Flight GC, lock the doors. Copy. Do folks listen up again on the flight loop? No. No phone calls. Off-site. Outside of this room, our discussions are on these loops, on the recorded Divas loops only. No data, no phone calls, no transmissions anywhere into or out.
Inside GC.
GC.
So we have no way of disabling the black phones.
I understand.
Make sure you know who those black phones are for, where they go. That, you know, they have this system that they have no control over. The other thing as well, watching the Columbia re-entry video in flight control center, is that they have very little idea of what's actually going on with the space shuttle. They are dependent entirely on the console in front of them. And in fact, there was broadcast on the local news channels a couple of hours before the NASA officials actually knew what had happened to the shuttle, they had broadcast people's home video footage of the shuttle burning up in re-entry, streaking across the Texan sky. So whilst NASA were in their bubble, and all of these engineers are dependent only on reading the data from their console, you know, they're not putting a picture together really, they're just providing data. So this is exactly how NASA is compartmentalized. Those guys in mission control during the Columbia re-entry did not know what was happening to the shuttle, and each one of them was only giving a small independent picture from their console readings. So when people are talking about, oh, Apollo 11, there were 400,000 people that worked on the Apollo program. Well, sure, but I'm sure that all 400,000 of them weren't sworn in members of said hoax. You know, the way it's grown and compartmentalized, like I say, much of these engineers are delivering actual engineering. So the problem with this guy is he went off-piste. So if you do your job within your parameters at NASA, you will be fine, and presumably your data will dovetail with other data and the picture will be presented as NASA wants it to be presented. But if people like this start doing their own independent thinking and their own checks, then the data is not going to correspond, and there are going to be problems in Houston. So bearing in mind that this film was in 1977, so it's kind of covering a lot of the conspiracy elements, some of the factors. There's the slow-mo part. So that's them acknowledging the fact that the video could just be slowed down to make it appear like they're on the moon. Don't forget, even though this is Mars in the movie, in the writer and the director's minds and heads, it's the moon. It's just, you know, so scrub Mars, forget that it's Mars. They've just written that in. I mean, you could cross out Mars and put the moon and just change the hue of that from red to green to brown. Grey, sorry. And it would scan. Yeah, it's never meant to be Mars. So, anyway. So, yeah, there's that knowledge of, acknowledgement of it's what you hear a lot of people say about Apollo. You know, it must be real. I saw it on TV. Yeah, I saw it on TV. It must be real. There's an acknowledgement of that. Oh, there it is.
It's Apollo 17's image of Earth, and they use it all the time, and nobody ever thinks about it. You're shown this. This picture is in every single science book. See that cirque cloud formation? This picture is so distinctive. They use it on the covers of magazines.
So there's your Apollo 17 photo. And next to it is Buzz Aldrin Apollo 11 photo. So there are two photos that are at the very heart and center of all this kind of NASA hoaxery. People have been all over that Buzz Aldrin photo. And this Apollo 17, well, we know this, don't we? So the guy here, we're focusing on kind of this photo on the left, which is Brubaker, and this guy. But really, the camera is well and truly focusing on that Earth picture. After seeing that Apollo 17 photo there, it triggered an alarm in my head about the flat Earth. And then this comes up.
Oh, it's nothing. Bruce said that he wanted to go back to Yosemite like last year. Last year we went to Flat Rock, not Yosemite. I don't think there's any cosmic significance in that.
So it turns out the entire key to the movie really is the word Flat Rock. And notice here in this shot how the directors really framed this shot. It's got the Flat Rock sign there, and then quite prominently the words photos and cameras. We know that Flat Rock is the key to unraveling the conspiracy in the movie. And here the director is associating photos and cameras with that fakery, with that hoax, because that's what it's all about, and that's what NASA are all about: photos and cameras. If you want to unravel NASA's fakery, it's photos and cameras that you need to focus on. So it's obviously it's used as a filming location. And so this is obviously tourist filming at Flat Rock.
Charles loved that one. He wasn't in the greatest mood, though. He didn't know it, but he was sick. Rue was fascinated with the detail. He couldn't get over how something so fake could look so real. He kept on saying that with that kind of technology, you could convince people of almost anything.
This is a standard thing in American kind of that post-war 50s, 60s and 70s culture. Always the, you know, the frustrated, misunderstood press reporter and having an argument with their boss.
You think the way to get ahead is to come up with the scoop of the century. Woodward and Bernstein were good reporters. That's how they did it. Not by telling me they've located Patty Hearst three times like you did, or that brilliant piece of investigative journalism you pulled off by finding an eyewitness to the second gunman in the Kennedy assassination. The small fact that the man had been in a mental institution at the time never deterred you, not Scoop Caulfield.
So the argument with the boss there sort of highlights the way, again, the way bosses work, you know, in the real world. Because in the conspiracy kind of world, when people are debunking, they get very kind of ideal world, and it's, you know, it just doesn't match with the actual real world of what it's like to work for bosses and managers in large organizations. The guy, he's clearly, this editor is clearly not interested in scoops, in conspiracies. So anyway, the astronauts are declared dead. They've obviously escaped and gone in separate directions, and they're being tracked down one at a time. Here's a Saturn V in this guy's office. There's an old style sailing ship. There's the Earthrise, which again is one of those photos that just looks completely fake. And there again is the Basaldwin photo. Yeah, in a later scene, they have it, there's that identical same photo from the hallway from before, which obviously ties these two characters together. So basically this is 3 days after they've escaped, so this is very much a kind of there's a serpent. So there's lots of biblical and Jesus and resurrection things here. So here's the the Illuminati one eye along with the serpent. So in this highly significant scene, he's gone into a cave here. It's very much reminiscent of the resurrection 3 days. And then in this scene here, he's killing the serpent with a flat rock. Now, if the serpent is representing NASA with its forked tongue logo and flat rock, the word flat rock has been the key to unraveling the conspiracy in the movie, and here he is also killing the serpent as well with flat rock. So one scene that everybody remembers when they seen this movie is the guy here eating the snake he's just killed, and out in utter disgust. So you can see as much symbolism in this in this scene here, you know, as you need, really. So just a little bit about the main character, Brubaker. If you look up the name Brubaker, no surprise to learn that it's from Germany. It apparently comes from Brugbach, meaning bridge. Brook, and that's where the name comes from, a bridge over the brook. Another source similarly tells us that Brugbach is a brook with a bridge. And here's an interesting shot from the movie when the reporter Caulfield is going to find out where his friend who worked at NASA has gone. These little bridges over brooks. Brubaker's, a little bit of synergy there. Let's take a look at this. So obviously, you know, you've got the blatant advertising, but we see past that because it's so blatant, it's pointless even pointing it out. But that, it's not pointless pointing out, because that is a clear reference to the Coke bottle that apparently was seen in an Australian transmission from the moon live, which has never resurfaced, because obviously that live transmission was then tampered with on the recordings, and it's never been released since. But there was a story that people in Australia swear to their dying day that whilst they were watching it on the TV on one of the moon landings, I don't think it was Apollo 11, it might have been, but they saw a Coke bottle on the moon.
As I watched this person walking, a Coke bottle in the lower right quadrant of the screen, it seemed to be kicked over and rolled across. And for me, that was just astounding, and I exclaimed aloud at the time, "It's a fake, it's a setup, they're not on the moon at all, look at this, it's a Coke bottle." And they were going to broadcast the same film again in the morning, and I phoned several of my friends, did you watch, and they hadn't, but they were going to watch in the morning. And I waited, of course, to say, well, did you see it? But it didn't happen. I watched the second telecast. There was no Coke bottle, which led me to believe at the time that it must have been edited out.
Your Coca-Cola bottling company congratulates the lunar astronauts. There is, however, just one little thing you should know about.
Two or three others of my acquaintance did see it. Furthermore, there were letters written to the West Australian newspaper. They mentioned the Coke bottle. And I waited for it to brew up. I thought, my goodness, there's going to be a glorious ding-dong here going on about this Coke bottle. But suddenly there was nothing at all.
I also decided to watch the Andromeda Strain after watching Capricorn One. I don't know why. Just another movie I haven't seen in a very long time. But a number of synchronicities and similar kind of triggers came out in this movie as well. The first thing that completely stood out for me, of course, 34 minutes in, and yeah, that's where they're heading. So the whole action of the Andromeda Strain takes place at Flat Rock, or in Flat Rock County. Oh well, that's actually where the scientific base is. Or more technically, it's underneath Flat Rock. So this is a very interesting bit at the very end of the Andromeda Strain. Now, as soon as I saw that, I recognised what that could be referring to. And sure enough, they confirm it in the movie, because they actually explain what this is. So what's happening here is they're watching on the monitor screen the Andromeda Strain, the actual physical Andromeda, and it basically does that. So I thought, wow, that's crashed, and that's an error, and they explain the error.
So one, the computer's overloaded. Too much data coming in too fast.
So that, for me, is a direct reference to the 1201 error that Apollo 11 got in the lunar module on the descent to the moon.
Houston, you're looking at our Delta H.
That's affirmative.
Program alarm.
Looking good to us. Over.
1202.
Roger, we got you. We're going at alarm. Roger, 1202, we copy it.
Copy. Alarm. 1201. 1201.
Roger, 1201 alarm. We're go, same type, we're go.
The other. Anyway, I then found out that Ridley Scott had done a remake of it, so I downloaded that and watched that. What they do differently in Andromeda Strain, and this is where the synchronicity kind of came a bit full circle for me, in the Ridley Scott remake is, remember my comments earlier in Capricorn One about the reporter, and it's a standard device. If you want to crowbar plot devices in and get a way of getting information out to the audience, stick a reporter there. You know, a TV or newspaper reporter, and they'll always put in friction and to and fro with his boss. And sure enough, they've done that in the Ridley Scott Andromeda Strain. It's not there in the original movie, but what they've done is they've pretty much taken the same character and the same relationship from the reporter and his boss in Capricorn One and crowbarred it into the Andromeda Strain.
I have to talk to you. I think I'm on to something. It could be your actual ball game. I mean it.
Golly gee, Scoop, that sounds very interesting.
Charlie, you're too good a producer to let your personal feelings get in the way of a great story.
How great?
Something's wrong. Something big. They know I'm on to it, and they try to kill me.
Who's they?
I can't tell you.
Why not?
You wouldn't believe me.
You don't think so?
NASA satellite crashes in southern Utah.
This is news? We call that gravity.
NASA claims it was a weather satellite. I know that's a lie. And why was an Army retrieval team sent to pick up, said NASA Bird? And why was that team from the Department of Biodefense?
If this is another one of your paranoid...
The whole unit died.
Look, when a reporter tells his assignment editor that he thinks he may be onto something that could be really big, the assignment editor is supposed to say... You got 48 hours, kids, and you better come up with something good, or it's going to be your neck. That's what he's supposed to say. I saw it in a movie.
All I need is a week to run this down, and a crew. A week and a crew, that's all I'm asking for.
Here we have the time argument that we just covered in Capricorn 1.
I'll give you 24 hours to come up with something, not 48.
3 days.
So there we go. There's a three-day motif again. So Capricorn 1, the action took place across 3 days. And here, this guy's got 3 days. That means that's the time scale of the action. That's what happens when they give the reporter the time scale. The reporter takes up to the minute of that time scale. So he said 3 days. So that means this action must be 3 days. Just like in Capricorn 1, the reporter had... a source. The source actually worked inside NASA.
Those signals couldn't have come from 300 miles.
Which signals?
The television transmissions.
I think I just sobered up. Would you tell me what you just told me again?
What the hell was that? Early this morning, there was an exchange between NASA and the Pentagon about a satellite codenamed Project Scoop that crashed in southern Utah.
But he had a source who disappeared.
Okay, listen to me. I got a tip from a friend, a good friend. Then he disappeared.
He disappeared?
Like he never existed.
And again, in the Andromeda Strain.
Hey, Charlie, what's up?
I've got some bad news about your friend. He's dead.
Here's an interesting visual shot for you from Ridley Scott's Andromeda Strain. Bingo. Isn't that beautiful? There's your pyramid. With a circle eye in the middle. Very nice. It was prominent in Capricorn 1. Serpent. Seriously, I had watched the original Capricorn 1, I watched Andromeda Strain, and then I watched Ridley Scott's Andromeda Strain from 2008, and it was like the third movie was an amalgamation of the previous two.
Maybe it has elastic properties we don't even know yet.
Maybe it has elastic qualities we don't know about.
So I'll leave the last word to the original Capricorn 1 cast and crew.
I believe that we landed on the moon, but I also believe that it would be possible to get a hoax over like that.
Originally, when they did step on the moon, there were a lot of people that said that that was not true.
Could they get away with it? Many people think they already have.
The Gallup poll has said to us that 28% of the American public didn't believe that we actually put a man on the moon.
Right forward. Good. 10, 20 feet.
100 feet, 3.5 down, 9 forward. 5%. On any bite? 75 feet. Guys looking good, down a half. 6 forward.
60 seconds.
Lights on. Down 2.5. Forward. Forward. Good. 40 feet down, 2.5. Picking up some dust. 30 feet, 2.5 down. Great shadow. 4 forward. 4 forward, drifting to the right a little. 20, down a half.
30 seconds.
Forward. Good. Contact light. Okay, engine stop. ATA at a descent. Hold control, both auto descent, engine command override off. Engine arm off.
We're home.
413 is in.
Man on the moon.
We copy you down, Eagle.
Listen,
Oh, jeez.
Tranquility Base here. The Eagle has landed.
Roger, Tranquility. We copy you on the ground. You got a bunch of guys about to turn blue. We're breathing again. Thanks a lot.
Oh, boy.
Thank you.
You're looking good here.
I remember Walter Cronkite was talking with somebody who was doing one of the Apollo shots. They cut to what they called a simulation, and it was mock-ups and models done on a stage, and it looked exactly like the real thing. And I said, wow, how do we know?
Or the questions one might ask would be, how valid is our government again? Here we've uncovered another area, another possibility where maybe we're being lied to again.
One just doesn't know what to think anymore.
Fly spec is supposed to be a length.
Wow. Speechless. Or the questions one might ask would be, how valid is our government again? Here we've uncovered another area, another possibility where maybe we're being lied to again.
Well, I think I've been the victim of a horrible deception.
One just doesn't know what to think anymore.